Hi, good evening. I wanted to thank everyone for joining us this evening. It's a pleasure to greet our donors, friends, and the guests from JFM. We're looking forward to hearing from our distinguished panel of speakers. Introduce myself, my name is BZ Halberstam. I have the great privilege of being an executive board member of the Jewish Communal Fund and a fund holder for almost two decades, hard to believe already. Just to tell you a bit about the Jewish Communal Fund for a moment before we begin the program, JCF manages approximately $1.4 billion in charitable assets for approximately 3,400 donor-advised funds. Donor-advised funds, if you're not familiar with, are really the fastest growing charitable tool, giving you incredible flexibility to manage your charitable dollars and to also distribute your charitable dollars. JCF staff takes care of almost all the record keeping, and it's just a very cost-effective, efficient way to distribute your charity and to focus on really what's most important for all of us, which is just giving out our charitable dollars. Funds can begin as low as $5,000. We have a private client group that begins at $1 million, and you're basically able to contribute and receive the full tax deduction currently if you donate stock. I became a fund holder through the sale of a private company, and Jewish Communal Fund was extraordinarily involved in the sale of my company to actually take a gift when it was still private and was able to actually sign on the purchase agreement. So it was really a very, very powerful tool to maximize the tax benefit to me and to set up a fund for what's now two decades. Important to me and to many others is that all the profits of the Jewish Communal Fund, it's a not-for-profit, so anything in excess of running a very lean office, all of it is distributed back to the Jewish community, and it supports a $2 million annual gift to the UJA, along with many, many other gifts that we're able to give to very important Jewish charities in the tri-state area. We regularly offer opportunities for donors and supporters to gather, as in evenings like this, to network and to share their ideas on how we can together increase our impact. We want to thank the Jewish Funders Network for helping create really what's an outstanding program tonight, and it gives us great pleasure to launch our first in our series of tools for philanthropic impact. It's my job to introduce our moderator, Dr. Jeff Solomon, the senior advisor to Chasbro Investments, which is the family office for Charles Bronfman. For 20 years, Jeff has served as the president of the Andrea and Charles Bronfman Philanthropies. It's a group of foundations many of us are familiar with that operate in Canada, Israel, and the United States. Jeff serves on many boards, including the Lifetag Foundation San Diego, the Jim Joseph Foundation in San Francisco, the chair of Leading Edge, which is an organization focusing on talent acquisition and retention within the Jewish community, serves as an officer of Peace Works, Diabetes Media Foundations, and the list goes on and on. I'm going to just shorten it in the interest of time. He is a founding trustee of the World Faith Development Dialogue and received numerous awards from professional associations and universities. I think in the packets we all have in front of us, we have full bios on Jeff and all the other panelists. It gives me great pleasure and honor to introduce Jeff Solomon.
Thank you, BZ. Welcome in behalf of both the Jewish Communal Fund and Jewish Funders Network. We're in for what is, I think, the most interesting, most important session you'll be at for a long time, which is how do we make decisions in charitable giving? How do we make decisions intelligently, strategically? And one of the amazing conundrums is it's hard to get it wrong. You know, there are better charities, worse charities, but I've never seen anybody say, oh, I made a big mistake. I gave to UJA Federation. It's too easy for us to not have the same intentionality in our charitable giving that we have in every other aspect of our lives. Those of us who are fortunate enough to be here and to be able to be thinking about charitable giving and to have donor-advised funds already have indicated some interest in being intentional. And I think what tonight will provide you with three extraordinary experts in the field and experts in their own giving, the tools that are necessary to intelligently make some of these critical decisions between right and right. Making decisions between right and wrong are easy. Making decisions between right and right are the challenge. So let me begin by introducing Sally Gottesman. Sally was the first employee of the Israel Women's Network and the first New York director of the New Israel Fund before attending the Yale School of Management for 15 years. She worked as a consultant to not-for-profit organizations, primarily in the Jewish community. She's worked on a host of boards, including American Jewish World Service, the Jewish Women's Archive, Jewish Funders Network, Bikkurim, and Congregation B'nai Jeshurun. 13 years ago, Sally co-founded Moving Traditions and has served as its chair since then, helping to develop it as the foremost organization working in the area of healthy Jewish teen identity. This spring, she will retire from that position and become the chair of Encounter, which brings influential Americans from across the political and religious spectrum to meet with Palestinians on the West Bank. I've asked each of the panelists to begin with a few minutes of their own thoughts in terms of the tools of making decisions. Then we're going to have a little conversation up here, and then hopefully we'll add you to the conversation. Sally?
Thanks, Jeff, and hi, everyone. So the evening tonight was talked about strategic philanthropy, and I used to think, like, what is strategic philanthropy, right? Like, I felt like it was some, like, you know, highfalutin definition. And then I realized that strategic philanthropy is really what will you stay interested in for a long time? Like, what area can you stay really interested in so that you get to know who the players are and what the field is? And that's what I actually really felt for, at least for myself. Like, I can be a strategic philanthropist when I know an area really, really well. And I think one of the challenges so many people have is like, well, what should I give to, right? When there's too much, there's that book, The Paradox of Choice, right? When there's so much choice, how do you know what to do? And in some ways, the best advice I ever got was, it's like, what articles do you read in the newspaper first, right? Like, when you get a newspaper, what do you read? What interests you? And I actually think that that helps figure out, you know, what areas you should give to. And then I think that also figuring out, well, what do I really care about? And does that line up with what I actually give my money to? So for myself, actually, I'm lucky. I'm like a, you know, the tortoise and the hare. I'm the tortoise. I've been interested in the same thing for about 40 years, 50 years, almost like 45 years, I would say. I've been interested in Jewish feminism. I've been interested in Israel. And so that led to my involvement in the creation of Moving Traditions. I was the co-founder of the creating of Moving Traditions because I was very interested in Jewish feminism and had a lot of experience in the Jewish community. But really, I once wrote an article about this for Michael Steinhardt's, you know, Contact magazine, was there were no organizations helping to young children think about Jewish feminism. There was a lot of work in the academy, but there was nobody translating the work that was happening in the academy for Amcha, for the people, and especially for kids. And so Moving Traditions, which has Rosh Chodesh groups for girls and Shevet Achim groups for boys and involves about 6,000 kids a year, teaching them about their own Jewish identity, but using a feminist and gender lens to approach some of those questions, I co-created with somebody else. And I really, in that article I wrote, like, I don't blame the men of the generation before me for not creating it. They weren't interested in those subjects. This was a new subject. And this was really about how do you take the academy out to the people. And I am really happy. We actually are an organization that's about a $5 million organization after these years. And so I'm actually happy that it has a very great board and a great staff, and I can move that on. Encounter, which brings American Jews to meet Palestinians, is an organization that I also really cared about Israel. I really think that it's the religious question of our time. It's like, what's going to happen with Israel? What's going to happen with the people who live on the West Bank, Gaza, the occupation? And I joined that board because I thought the organization had a great product, but it wasn't selling itself to the right people. And it was bringing really rabbinical students over who were in their 20s who were living in Israel. And I actually thought, like, how can we take this great product and make it better? But in terms of giving, it was actually Aliza, who you'll hear from in a minute, was doing some consulting for Encounter. And she said to me, who can you raise money for this? I had joined the board. And I remember sitting on my couch at home. I was like, you know, I was being interviewed. So I sit on my couch and I thought, really, the person I can raise money for this is from myself. right? Like I can go raise, you know, $1,000, $5,000, maybe $10,000 from, you know, some people are interested. But I have a fund, the Jewish Communal Fund. I'm fortunate to have, you know, financial resources. And I realize like I could give a lot of money to this organization and help to turn it around and actually raise the bar of what is considered what the staff of this organization can do and what other funders will do if I'm willing to take the lead. So actually I'm happy to say that I did that, and the organization has actually, you know, growing. And I think that's important in strategic philanthropy, like making that leap, right? And then finally, actually, something that I wasn't interested in until my daughter was, I have a 10-year-old daughter who has a disease called neurofibromatosis, NF1. And it is known for creating benign tumors on your body, but like 17 different things go wrong. So when she was diagnosed at 6 months, I went to the major organization that works on it, the Children's Tumor Foundation, gave them money, and think that they do a really good job and continue to fund them. But I became interested because like 17 things can go wrong in this disease, and it actually has to respond to all the people who give money to it. They really portion their money out to, like, you know, people who research in these 17 different areas. And I was interested, what would happen if somebody really gave significant funds to just one aspect of the disease and was set up a research center that would only, you know, that would, where it was solely dedicated to looking at one symptom. So with my family, we set up a center at Hopkins, at Johns Hopkins, that looks at plexiform tumors, which are a complicated tumor that develop with people with those diseases. So that's sort of my three biggest things. The only other word that I would want to add is that I think that we should, as funders, since we're all funders in this room, I think that it's important to ask what are the right organizations, but I also think it's right for us to ask, and something that we don't get asked because people are afraid of their funders, is what does it mean to be a good funder? And there are three things that I just want to mention. I'm very wary of people asking for project funding. Like a lot of people come to me and say, we do women and girls and da 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 da. I actually think the question is, do you support the organization overall most of the time, especially as an individual funder, unless you're gonna make a really a major long-term grant to the organization. I think that as funders, we should really try to support the organization's overhead and operations overall. And like, I don't think people, but organizations rarely tell you that because they want to raise money from you. So that's one thing. Because I've now gotten more involved in the Israel world again, I've returned to it. I am very worried about donors exerting influence around Israel in ways that are really destructive to people wanting to be professionals in the American Jewish community. We took a trip of 24 professionals, like great Hillel directors, great rabbis, great employees from all the organizations that you guys know the names of. And not one person except for me and one other, there was one other funder on this trip. We were the only two people who felt like we could go on this encounter trip and not be scared of like who our funders were and what our board, the implications of our board were gonna be. And I almost wonder whether there shouldn't be a pledge that people sign, that funders will sign saying that they won't take away their money from the organizations they belong to because of what the professionals will do about Israel, right? Like these are, you know, these are people who like have spent their lives being rabbis and are afraid that people will know that they've gone on this trip, right? And rabbis are major congregations, and really they're trying to learn about the complexity of the issue. So one of my questions is, should we have a pledge form? Like, what are we asking our funders to do besides just like, you know, do whatever they want? And then finally, this seems very simple, but I see a lot that funders start pulling their funding. If you have the capacity to be a major funder, I think we don't realize, like, actually the Children's Tumor Foundation, it's a multi-million dollar organization, but there's only 150 people who give $5,000 or more to the organization. And I think if people think, oh, I give $5,000, it's not that much. But very often I think your funds matter more than you might know. And that if you're gonna start, it's okay to decide you don't wanna fund something anymore. But really, I think like almost like Derek Harris, like the kind thing to do is tell the organization that actually I'm gonna start, you know, I'm gonna take away my funding, I'm gonna reduce my funding and give them some time to know that in their planning. Because every year organizations sit there and they think like, are they gonna give X, you know, usually I think they're going to give the same thing. And I feel like as funders, nobody ever will tell you, you know what, ugh, we hate that you did that, right? Or, you know, why didn't you just give us warning? Not that you can't change your funding, but if you know you're getting less interested in something, that would be the last thing I would say strategically for the funders and the organizations themselves.
Thank you. Aliza Mazor is the executive director of Bikkurim, Advancing Jewish Ideas, a joint project of the Jewish Federations of North America and the Kaminer family. Bikkurim has supported 33 innovative startups that contribute significantly to the diversification and reinvigoration of Jewish life. Bikkurim prepares the most promising new initiatives in Jewish life to grow their impact. Previously, Aliza served as an independent organizational consultant to philanthropies, capacity builders, and social justice organizations. And one of the things we will hopefully get into, because we're going to be here for 2 weeks, that subject requires no less than 2 weeks, is the whole question of funding innovation versus funding legacy programs. So, Aliza, a few opening words.
Sure. I think, you know, I love the way you started this, Sally, by saying, what is strategic philanthropy? It sounds like a buzzword. And I think over the years I've come to understand that strategic philanthropy is really about clarity. It's about being extremely clear internally first within your foundation or your board of trustees or whoever's making the granting decisions, and then transparent with the people with whom you potentially will give grants and have relationships. And being just extremely clear, and I'll say that from a place when I started in my role at Bikkurim, we weren't very clear. It wasn't because we weren't trying to be good about what we were doing or we weren't trying to be strategic. It was that we had a really broad definition of what innovation was, and we kind of had a sniff test, and we'd say, well, you know, we know it when we see it, and we like this project, and that's innovative, and let's fund it. And it took us many years and a lot of hard work to really evolve a definition of innovation that I will say was very clear to us, and still we had trouble communicating it externally. But we came up with a definition that basically said what we wanted to do was increase access and lower barriers to participation in Jewish life. We were looking for new projects, not things that had been, not organizations or initiatives that had been in existence for a long time. We felt that we're lucky in the Jewish community that there's lots of funders that support those things, so we wanted to be on the side of supporting things that were new and getting their start, that they needed to meet an unmet need, that it could be something that was new to the Jewish community but not new to everybody in the world, meaning we want to take great models that are working outside the community and adapt them for our own use, and that we really wanted to push for projects that were updating kind of big Jewish ideas, but that were either, you know, rebooting them or putting an interesting twist on them or making them current in some way. So that's how we got to our definition of innovation. And then we wanted to line innovation up with what is potential for impact. So you don't just want to fund something because it's a shiny new idea and it's really interesting. You want to make sure that it can actually make a difference over time. And then we had to look at feasibility, we had to look at good leadership, we had to look at organizational soundness, which maybe I'll talk a little bit more about later. And over the years, our 18 years of operations, we feel like we've developed a lot of expertise around what is a healthy startup, what does an organization look like, what does health and robustness look like when you're a young starting organization, and also what does it look like when you're a post-startup, when you've kind of gone past the 10-year mark. You're a bit of an adolescent organization, not a fully mature legacy organization because we haven't done our work there, but what do those kind of adolescent organizations look like, and what does health look like at that stage? And I'll talk a little more about that later.
Thank you. Scott Shay was a founder of Signature Bank and has been its chairman of the board since its inception. He's also a co-founder of Ranieri Partners. He's recently served as a board member of UJA Federation of New York, the Partnership for Excellence in Jewish Education, the Jewish Agency for Israel, the Birthright Israel Steering Committee, and the American Hebrew Academy. He is the president of Chai Mitzvah and is chairman of the Lapid Advisory Board Coalition of Nonprofit Israel Teen Trip Groups. He and his wife Susan are the founders of Jewish Youth Connection, and he's the author of a book that I commend to you, Getting Our Groove Back, How to Energize American Jewry. Scott?
Thank you. So I'd like to start with a story. One thing that I'm privileged with being chairman of Signature Bank is to meet a lot of people who in some cases have just sold their companies or have come into money or just have earned a lot of money, and they're thinking about their what they want to do philanthropically. And sometimes I get in conversations where I think I'm at the precipice of annoying this client so much that he or she will leave because I press them a bit. And frequently, I find that individual donors don't have a very strategic view. They're involved in things that their friends are involved with. They're involved with things that are very nice. They're involved with things that are sexy. They're involved in, you know, sort of what the current trends are. And I really push people, again, and to the point of them staying clients, I don't push too hard, but to really think hard about that intersection of what they have the resources to do, what they're interested in, and what needs to be done. Because a lot of times, those three lines actually don't intersect. And so things that don't get need to get done get funded. Things that need to get done don't get done. And sometimes people aren't very interested in it, and so they keep moving from thing to thing. So all of those are easy to make mistakes. I wrote an article, which is in the your booklet, which I think is a very important one from that and came out of this, I say so myself, as it were. It's from nice to effective. And it's sort of a play on, you know, in a way from good to great or the like, which is there are lots of things that are nice. There are lots of programs that are nice. It's as was said before. It's hard to make a mistake, Jeff began. I mean, you can't go wrong. You're not wasting your money frequently. But how can you go from doing something that's really nice to something where you, in your position, are going to make the most impact? And I would just say a couple of things with respect to that, and we'll presumably get into this more in the conversation, which is one of the good things about being not being part of a major foundation is that everybody in this room, I've been a I've had a donor advised fund for probably 25 years or so. I'm guessing Sue can probably give a precise number, but I've been involved with trying to do donating strategically for a long time, and Susan and I, my wife, would talk about, you know, what we were going to do, and we think of ourselves as in a way as a foundation, if you will, in that I try to allocate 10%, more or less, some years more, it depends what's going on, some years, you know, in 2008 maybe. A little less, but more or less 10% of what our earnings are in terms of a charitable donation. So that gives, in a sense, a budget. But the nice thing is that we don't necessarily feel like we have to spend that every year. We can use the Jewish Communal Fund to basically bridge years that are there's a little more to that 10, or there's a little less to that 10, or so percent. And be effective. And the thing that we can do is we can stick with things a lot longer than a private foundation generally has the stomach to do. Even Avichai is now going out of business, and you know they've stuck with some things for a very long time, and other foundations. And I think that's actually probably a good idea that you know the foundation that Jeff chaired decided to put itself at a certain point, to spend the assets and to go out of business. I think it's very healthy. We as individual funders have the ability to stick with things or to end them. And I mean, I think you have to end them with Derech Eretz. But I just came back from Israel because over a little less than 20 years ago, my wife and I approached the Tali school. Tali Educational Network, which at the then was just really getting going, mostly in preschools. And we agreed to fund three schools to get our feet wet. And it was a propitious time. Bank United had just gone public, and we decided this is something we could do. And we have stuck with it. We've helped them. I've been involved personally in their strategic planning, and I just came back because they had the 40th anniversary, which I felt very, very much a part of. And we were able to do that for a long period of time. And today that organization is a very different organization than it was when we started with it. You also have the ability to start things. Personally, I've started High Mitzvah, which is about adult Jewish education. And you have another opportunity, which I've now gotten to understand, and this I'll conclude with and we can move on, but I've gotten to realize is much more important. I was on the board of Bank Hapoalim for about 8 years, and I had this bee in my bonnet that the banks in Israel and the investors in Israel really weren't doing a good job of investing in the periphery, in the north and the south. You had a lot of investment going for high tech in the center of the country, in Herzliya Pituach and Tel Aviv. You know, startup nation, high tech, cybersecurity in Beersheba. But the north and the south really weren't being developed. And all the high tech, even if you include the restaurants that serve the high tech community, it's maybe 6% of the Israeli population is tied to high tech. So I spent literally years thinking about this problem. Thought about it with some Israelis for a period of time and thought about a philanthropic answer to it. And finally came to the answer that the way to really really have an impact was to start a for-profit fund to invest in companies in the north and the south. Those are the kind of things that we as individuals have the flexibility to do. And that's really a great gift, and hopefully we all, you know, figure out that intersection for ourselves, what we can do, what we will do, and what needs to be done.
Thanks, Scott. Every so often during our time together, I'm going to just make a note of some things that I've heard. One of the things that I heard from the three of you is how much time you spend thinking about this. And that comes back to the question of intentionality and how important it is to think about it. And I would argue that all the gifts we make for one of three reasons. Either our autobiography, or the autobiography of our family. So if we had a university scholarship, we are loyal to that university for our whole lives. Because of relationships, somebody asks us to support an organization that they're interested, or ultimately, strategy, when we develop our own sense of strategy. So the first question I'd like to ask the three of you is, Tom Tierney, who was a partner in Bain & Company and started Bridgespan, define strategic philanthropy in three words: fewer, longer, bigger. Does that resonate with you? And if it does, how much of your philanthropy fits into it? And if it doesn't, why not? Lisa, do you want to start?
I'll start. We fewer and longer, but not bigger. Well, and bigger and with an exception. Fewer and longer, I think, has always been, it's been an approach of Bikkurim since the beginning, that we work intensively with a small number of organizations. In the years that we ran our incubator, we would have four or five organizations in the incubator at a time. Maybe at our maximum, we had 11. And then we realized that was too much because we couldn't give them the attention and the investment that we wanted to give them. So we pared it back down. We've always been able, partly because of the generosity of the Kaminer family, to run a very focused, I would say, boutique program. So focusing in on a few. We, in our incubator period, would incubate organizations for 4 to 5 years. That's when they're startups. And in our newest initiative, which is around second stage, more adolescent organizations, we do a 2-year investment. There we did decide to go bigger. We went from giving very little cash in our incubator program to making $100,000 investments in each of our second stage organizations. And part of the reason we went bigger on that was really believing that these were some of the most promising ideas in Jewish life, and they needed a lot of help to get over a certain hump. And also that we were going to invest in infrastructure, which is something that funders don't usually invest in, don't usually give organizations money for, but is critical to their success. So we were going to focus on investing in infrastructure, and also everything we do at Bikkurim is coupled with capacity building. So the capacity building, I think, also fits in our longer, deeper, more, you know, basket of putting a lot of time and energy into these organizations.
I really strongly identify with each of those words. And really, Tom Tierney's work is, I think, and several other thinkers, and Joel Fleischman is one that I would, you know, who's written about smart philanthropy. I also consider a mentor, actually. But it, for me as an individual, I have a full-time day job. It has to be fewer. And indeed, I've told people occasionally when I have been approached on something that I really think is very interesting. For example, I've taken on the chair of Lapid, which is this organization of teen travel groups to Israel. Well, for about 5 years prior to that, I had said to them, this is very important to me. As you've read my book, you know I think teen travel to Israel is critical. But I did not have the time. I couldn't focus on it. I could write a check to them. It's not a major check, but I'd write a check, but I couldn't really focus on it until, you know, sort of I felt like another project was safely being, piloted by someone else, or someone had taken over that work. And in that case, it was the Jewish Youth Connection. And so that's when I really started working on that. So I only have limited bandwidth personally, and I don't like to take things on that I'm not going to focus on. So I'm really into the fewer. And if I find something, I will amend the word bigger to say potentially bigger, because if I think that it's important, I want to do fewer and, you know, have fewer eggs in the basket and focus on those eggs very well, and longer for sure. Because I think, and this is something that I like to say in the business world when I'm talking in business, when I'm talking in business schools and the like, which is that people generally overestimate what they can accomplish in the short run and underestimate what they can accomplish in the long run. And I'll give you a quick example on Signature Bank. When we formed Signature Bank, the first day I got up when we just had started the bank, and it was literally we were starting the following Monday, and I said, my goal for Signature Bank is that in 5 years we'll be a $5 billion bank, and in 10 years we'll be a $10 billion bank. Which actually would have meant slower growth, but that's sort of what came out of my mouth. You know, it was everybody together, and that's what I said. Well, the reality is in 5 years we were a $3 billion bank. But we were doing what we were supposed to be doing and doing it well, and I felt like we were getting traction. In 10 years, we weren't a $10 billion bank. We were a $14 billion bank. And in our 15th anniversary, which just happened, we're a $37 billion bank. I don't mean that as an advertisement for Signature Bank, but I mean that as an example of we made sure we had the basics right. When we were all comfortable with that, we could grow beyond what we actually thought we could grow. Nobody thought we would be as big as we are. And I think that's the same thing about the Talis schools too. I would have not thought that 10% of Israeli children would be involved in a Talis school when we got involved with it. I would have said that's like really not possible. Now, not only is that happening, but Minister Bennett is talking about funding it from the state. You know, so that is because of a lot of hard work over a longer period of time, and hopefully the fruits will be that much tastier.
I think that I can't say I actually always aspire to give to fewer organizations, but can't say that I always do because I really care about many of the things. But I definitely write checks to those organizations, right? Like it's time that's limited, right? So if I care about an organization, I don't want to hear about it every year, right? Like there's some people who, many organizations like that. Some organizations I really do want to hear about for one reason or another and want to meet the people and hear what's going on. But definitely focus on I can only focus on a few organizations. I remember when I actually used to be a fundraiser that I remember I liked individual giving because they said that, I think I learned that the average individual gives to an organization for 11 years. Right, so it was like a very good, the return on investment was good if you could find somebody interested in your organization. And I think that's really just true for myself. I mean, if I look at my own funding, I mean, some organizations, you know, I think it's longer partly because I just get older, right? there are organizations I really have cared about for, like Scott, like for, you know, 20, 30 years now because they're still doing their work and they haven't solved the underlying problem of whatever that problem might be. And I think for individuals, it's like bigger. I mean, it's interesting. Like, how do you decide? It,
Scott, you talked about giving 10% of your money, you know, of your income away. And I think that this question of like, how do we, it's another question I think funders have, how do you challenge yourself to give more money away, right? Like, I think that in the end, many people squirrel their money away. You know, they put it in the Jewish Communal Fund, they're like happy to have it, and then they like never want to get rid of it. That's why you actually have money that you can actually, I mean, I'm happy that you guys give this money away. But, you know, why aren't your donors giving the money away, right? Why don't they care enough to figure out what it is? And I think that I think I constantly challenge myself, or at least certainly every year, to challenge myself to figure out how can I, you know, I have more money than I need to live, and how can I actually take more and more of that money and give that away? Because that will have much more impact than where I give the money to, if you have wealth in that capacity.
You raised one of the thorniest issues before, the issue of overhead. Let's spend a few minutes on number one, what are the tools to learn about the portion of a budget that goes to things other than program services? And number two, what would you advise donors to be looking at? Because there are simple answers, you know, and I've never seen anybody go into Starbucks and say, you know, well, you want $4.50, but I'm only going to give you $4 because I'm not going to pay for your rent. yet we do this to charities all the time. So I'd love all three of you to comment a little bit on both the tools and an approach to overhead.
I'll start. So particularly with small organizations, when you're talking about startups, you really ought to be giving them general support. When they're at the beginning, it is very hard to differentiate what they're doing as this project versus that project versus that project. And it often sends particularly small, understaffed, under-infrastructured organizations running around to catch their tail to figure out, how do I give this donor a project? They want a project. They don't want to support us. If you like the idea, as Sally said, support the idea. The idea is going to take years to grow and get wings. And if you believe in it and you're an early believer, then you've got to be an early investor and you got to stick with it for a little while. I really believe in giving general support. I don't know how many times in different ways I can say that. I think if you're going to give project support, then give general support as well. Meaning if you can only give project support for whatever reasons, give project support that covers the full cost of running the project and doesn't expect the organization to say, the staffing, we'll throw that in, the rent, we'll throw that in. And then I'm going to make a big pitch here for the least exciting element of organizational life, infrastructure. Help the organizations you love build their infrastructure. Help them figure out data management and pay for the hardware and for the expertise so that they can really measure what they're doing and really talk about their impact. Help them pay decent salary and benefits so that they can hire and retain good talent. It's not great to run an organization where every 2 years your entire staff turns over because you're only paying these professionals $40,000 a year and you're not giving them any health insurance. And that is really the case in a lot of our smaller Jewish organizations, and it's just not fair. Help them fund evaluation and study what they're doing and learn about it. Helping an organization create a learning loop so that they really understand what they're doing and why what they're doing works is a gift beyond measure. Help them with staff development. Help them with strategic planning and other forms of capacity building. If you're working with an organization and you're in partnership with them for the long term, and you identify a weakness, and usually when you're a donor and an investor, you are in a privileged position to kind of hold up a mirror and say, I really love what you're doing, but here's a place where I think you're weak organizationally. And then couple that with, and I'm willing to help you address that weakness. And here's some kinds of help we could get, and here's how I would help you find that help. Or as Scott was saying before, I'll dive in, I'll help you with your strategic plan. I'll help you with the next phase of what you're doing in a more hands-on way. Help fund R&D for the organizations that you love. Help them develop their next great idea. And then the thing that costs you nothing is be a champion for their work. If you really love an organization, you've got to be out there talking about what they do and singing their praises. And I think that is a form of general operating support. It's not financial support, but it is, I'm going to be out there and I'm going to help talk up your work and I'm going to introduce you to others and I'm going to help you be great.
No, I think that there's no one metric on overhead, but if you're closely enough, if you're close enough to the organization and you're aware of what's going on, I think you can get a sense of whether there's too much overhead. I was once in a company that I was with Lou Ranieri, who was my longtime partner with years ago, and we went in and he said, when we walked out of the door, I remember the door closed and he said, you know, if we went and we shot every third person and then came back 2 months later and again shot every third person, there'd still be too much overhead here. And I actually haven't, and I had to agree with him. We didn't go for it. But I have to say, I don't really see that generally in Jewish organizations. What I do see occasionally is, you know, some ineffectiveness or the like. But I really don't see that in too many organizations. I think we have to, I agree, I believe that, you know, funding overhead is part of what makes the organization go. I do try to encourage organizations where I think it could be done cheaper. For example, where items can be outsourced, IT, or, you know, because they got, you know, Yossi doing the IT. And or you know, and we don't really, we could really, you know, have, I don't know, hyperlink or pick your name of the outside sources. I hope your name isn't you don't have Yossi doing the IT at JCF or JFN, but you know what I mean. So I try to help organizations that I'm involved with think about the cheapest way to do that, so that the spending is all on the program or the fundraising. Frankly, I mean, I think that's obviously critical as well. But, you know, organizations don't necessarily have to be expert at certain things. They don't have to be expert at HR. They can outsource HR. I mean, I can tell you that's what, you know, certainly Chai Mitzvah does. And I think it's incumbent upon us to try to work with groups to do that.
Yeah, I would agree that I don't see a lot of too much overhead in Jewish organizations. I think it's funny. There's this I think there's a question like what it's almost like a, you know, intuitive, like how much money could you spend per person? I remember one, I'm good friends with somebody who was a dean at HUC in New York, and we sat down, we were having dinner, like we're like organizational wonks, right? So we sat down and I thought of what's the total budget of moving traditions and how many teens participate and how many hours a year basically are these teens participating, and we divided out what's the cost per hour of kids. And she figured out what's the overhead or what's the cost of HUC and how many rabbinical students and cantorial students and, you know, how many years or how many hours a day in class and this and that, and, you know, what's the cost per hour per student. Like, this is how we, like, this was like a fun dinner exercise. But I think that there does come some point of like, I do, this is like as a funder actually, or as the chair of organizations, I think like, in some ways, I do think like, well, it can't cost more than X or Y to per kid in our groups or to bring a person on an encounter trip, you know, per encounter trip, because otherwise the funders are going to think it's like just too much overhead. And, you know, in fact, that person's no longer at HUC. She's up in Amherst. And I was taking the Peter Pan bus home and figuring out how many people does encounter need to bring on these 4-day trips? Like, how many buses do we need to run? So that, you know, it becomes, you know, is $10,000 a person seems unacceptable to me. $5,000 a person seems like in the acceptable range. And it's really, in some ways, that was my feeling until we started talking to other funders. But I do sort of look at the organizations where I'm a bigger investor. I think of that question.
Do any of you use Charity Navigator or GuideStar?
Yes. But I want to throw that at you for a second.
Okay, go ahead.
Because, you know, you were the birth mother to a great degree, the joint birth mother, I don't know exactly how that works, of birthright. And you actually set the metric of we can spend X dollars per student and send them to Israel. And if we say spend more than that, we're not going to raise the money. How did you think about the overhead in the situation and you know, the cost per the sort of bang for the buck when you were getting Birthright going?
Well, we combined it with a very intense valuation process, where Brandeis, the Cone Center at Brandeis, was looking at the degree to which every participant who went achieved the goal of increased Jewish identity, increased connection to Israel, increased connection to the Jewish people. And by the third year, they were able to say, Earthright at $3,000 per capita provides just less than 6 years of day school at $180,000 per capita, and is a great bargain. And for many donors, that's a very attractive picture. But I also think, you know, just coming back to the issue of overhead, last year I made a gift to Birthright of $12,000 to cover the cost of relationship science software. Nothing could be more boring than relationship science software, except it helps the fundraisers in obtaining major gifts. And this is, for me, this was a lesson from the Kresge Foundation. Kresge Foundation historically has been very generous on capital projects all over the country, including to many Jewish organizations. The Kresge Foundation's approach was, we will fund the least popular thing. If you need to put a sewage treatment plant in the new JCC, we'll fund the Jewish sewage treatment plant, because we know donors don't like to fund sewage treatment plants. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's a real opportunity, I think, for smart giving when it comes to saying, how can I lever my gift? And very often overhead is an opportunity to lever one's gift. We're going to open it up after one more question, which is another consideration. And you know, this is the challenge of strategic giving, is that there are so many considerations. But another consideration is geographic. Do you give locally? Do you give nationally? Do you give in Israel? Where do each of you come down on that question, and why? What drove you to look at geography in a certain way? Sally, maybe we'll start with you.
It's funny, I was just talking about that today. I think that what happens in Israel is going to have a huge impact on what happens to the Jewish people. So Israel is important in my giving because I just believe that's true, whether, you know. So I'm actually interested in funding Israel because I think that that's just a given. Or to me, it's a given. And I think that and I was involved in my synagogue and with BJ. But I think as a New Yorker, I don't feel that identified with New York. I mean, I feel like I've been involved in national organizations otherwise, simply because I don't feel like that small communal feeling. And I actually feel it's less of a problem for the organizations I'm involved with in New York. Actually, when we raise money almost throughout the rest of the country, when I try to raise money for, I'll use Moving Traditions, people want to know that we're going to affect the girls in their community, so Chicago, Denver, whatever, San Francisco. They want the money to stay in their community. And I find that happens less in New York, right? I think people care a little bit less because I just think that it's harder to get that communal, really the feeling of community, I think. And so I'm probably like just like that. I don't feel so tied to the New York Jewish community. And because because I can be so strategic here, because there are so many organizations that fit every person's needs, I became, I think, more interested in the national Jewish community.
Scott? I'd have to say my answer is similar. I mean, I'm a big believer you can't do everything, so you have to focus. And so my focus has been more national and Israel, but I do also do a lot of New York. I live here. I'm sensitive to the issues around New York. So I'd say I focus on those three arenas. If someone, you know, asked me to get involved in something in Denver or something, you know, unless it's a personal friend and it's a one-time, you know, just tag-along gift, I really, I'm actually getting more and more ruthless about saying no. I say no much more now than I did 10 years ago, because I'd almost rather not even hear again from that organization, because I don't even want to give it that mind space. So it may sound ruthless, but it just helps me focus.
We do local and national. When we do national, they have to be headquartered in New York. We've made one exception to that for an organization headquartered in Boston. But primarily, we didn't set out to do it this way, but it just became clear to us that we want to have a kind of close working relationship. And in order to do that, we need organizations with some geographic proximity, because we're doing capacity building as well as funding.
Thank you. I ask you to join the conversation, open it up to questions. This is the awkward moment when the therapeutic use of silence will get one of you to feel guilty enough to ask the question that's on your mind. Sir.
That's an excellent question. I'm going to give you, I'd like to, no, or should I? The question is, how does a funder get detailed information to do due diligence, because GuideStar information and Charity Navigator information may be too high level. Is that a fair statement? To shorten, you know, just... So here's the thing I think everybody in this room shouldn't be bashful about, which is, if you're thinking about making any kind of significant gift, call the organization and ask for their financial statements, first of all. Mm-hmm. Take a look at who their auditor is. See if they've had a full audit. In New York, if a not-for-profit has revenues of more than $100,000, it's required to have an audit. At some level, it's required to have a review. I don't remember what that number is offhand, but take a look at it and read it, and read the footnotes if you're going to make a significant donation. There's lots that is found in the footnotes. It seems like, that's where you really find out what's going on. And you can get the 990. That you can get through, I believe, Charity Navigator, if I'm not mistaken, and GuideStar. GuideStar, I'm sorry. The 990 Finder, you can get it. And I think you can link directly from the Jewish Communal Funds. If you're going to give a gift, you can actually link directly to some of those sources and get the 990. I do take a look at them. I will say this, that because I'm involved in fewer, bigger, longer, I tend to be deeply involved in the organizations I'm giving to, that I'm giving to larger sums of money. But I think it's important that you ask those questions. I think it's important you ask the charities those questions. There have been widely publicized issues, between Met Council, FAGS, and others, and other not-for-profits outside of the Jewish world. And I think that one thing Sally talked about, donor, sort of what donors should do and donor responsibility, I think, we should take on the responsibility of doing a bit of due diligence. There's nothing wrong with asking to speak to the CFO. Obviously, if there's some determined fraud, like what happened in Met Council, well, that's not going to help you. But it will give you a sense in, 99% of the situations.
The only thing I would add is I agree totally about, looking. I went to business school because actually I was working at the New Israel Fund, and I realized I never read the back of the annual report for 4 years where the financials were. And I'm like, oh, my God, I got to go to business school. I might be forced to learn this. So in some ways, I think the information is there. You'll never find it if somebody's trying to hide it, right? And then there's this sense of, I guess, of like trusting yourself. Just today I was looking at an organization I didn't know about that was, I mean, I think there was budget, was $700,000. It was clear, they raised about 30% of their money from programs that they run, 60% from some foundations, and really only $42,000 from individuals. But they had this very glossy annual report, right? Now, maybe they're making it for the few foundations that fund it. But I actually thought, like, well, that's a weird investment in that they really probably have five people who are funding the organization, you know, maybe 100 who are all given, you know, $100. And it was just like a weird use of money, right? Like, it wasn't like I was going to write the organization off totally. But I did actually ask that question. And, like, I feel like it's like, if I was, I was looking for something else, but I thought, well, I'd actually ask them about that choice of, you know, making this very big glossy report. When, who's this for? Was really, my question was, who's this for?
I also think beyond financial due diligence, which is clearly, you know, important that an organization is run soundly and run properly, you want to also make sure that they have the capacity to deliver on the things they're talking to you about, and those you may not see in the financials. So I think that, you know, if you don't have capacity to do deep due diligence, there's a couple shortcuts include talking to other funders, particularly, you know, foundation funders are often willing to share a little bit of their assessment of the organizations they support, why they support them, why they think they do a good job at what they're doing. I'd feel out a little bit, and I think you can sometimes even do this with Google. Is that a terrible tool to use? Feel out their reputation. Do they have a strong reputation? Do others regard them as experts in their field? Are they called upon as experts? I mean, those are all sorts of things you can start to feel out as you get to know an organization. And I actually think even if you're a sole funder without a lot of time and energy to put into it, having a meeting, having a site visit, finding some way to get to know them if you're going to make a significant investment makes a lot of sense. Some of your hunches will tell you a lot about who they are, how they're doing what they're doing, whether they're ethical, all those kinds of things.
I would only add one thing. Aliza just used the term investment. I think all of our charitable giving, we have to think of them as investment. And the return on investment is very different because we're looking for impact as the return on investment. And so I think a piece of the due diligence when you have those conversations is to ask the question, what do you define as impact in your work? And how, in fact, are you measuring that impact? And if you get a blank stare, consider another organization. Sir. It's a very good question.
Good question.
When you buy stock, when you buy 100 shares of AT&T, and you go to the annual meeting, do you feel comfortable? You know, in some ways, I think the same dynamic is at work. To what degree, you know, if your contribution represents 5 or 10% of the total budget, you know, you certainly should be asking those questions. Your contribution represents more than that. You should be asking questions about when are you going to have a budget that brings my proportion down below 10%, because it's in mature organizations, it's not healthy to not have diversification among funders.
I would say if you're giving more than 1%, total organization's budget, you definitely have the right to sit down. I mean, I think you should feel like you have that right. And then if you don't feel like you have that right, or the organization doesn't feel like you have that right, I think you have to give it serious consideration whether you want to keep funding.
Mm-hmm.
Lisa?
I think it all depends on budget size and also what are their other income streams. So if an organization is primarily reliant on fee for service and you're one of a handful of donors, even if they have income from elsewhere, you're pretty significant. If they have a lot of big foundation donors at the table and the individual donors make up a small portion of the budget, you're less significant. Right. I think it really depends. I will say, though, with the innovation organizations and the organizations that are in startup mode, $5,000 is generally considered a significant gift.
Thank you.
This gets back to the issue of it's hard to make mistakes, because we can each passionately talk about areas, you know, serving the Jewish elderly, serving children, education. And to the degree that each of us creates our own sense of strategy is the degree to which we can each change the world. And I thank you for your comments, because your commitment to education is the kind of thing that will make a difference, as opposed to people I know, and you probably know those people also, who in December get 150 solicitations and pile them up and sit with their checkbook and, you know, decide how they want to be Santa Claus. Having, and Scott began his comments before, having a budget is a critical part of the strategic philanthropy. And a donor-advised fund makes having a budget so much easier. Other questions?
I would just add one thing to what this one said. I actually think that I have enjoyed doing some stuff that I
doing different types of work, right? So when you were talking about helping a family, like by chance many years ago, I met a 15-year-old girl in Poland, a Jewish girl, and I said, what do your friends think of your being Jewish? And she said, I've only told my best friend. And I was like, oh my God, there, but for the grace of God, go I, right? And so like I have not done a lot of investment in individuals because I really believe in bigger change. And tonight, actually, I want to say, we've been talking about Jewish philanthropy, but I think that, you know, like, does your dollar go further when you would fund the non-Jewish community? So that's a whole nother topic that I think could be addressed in your two-week seminar. But I have gotten, even though it didn't make me do a lot of funding of individuals, I've gotten a lot of, oh, so anyway, I ended up helping her go to Israel and study and blah, 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 the whole life. And now she's 27 and lives in Israel and married to some Turkish guy, like these dying Jewish communities. And I've actually got a lot of satisfaction, I think. And she has a mother and father who are alive. So basically I can help to fund her. And, you know, it's not, whatever, I can't write it off as a tax deduction type thing. But it's been very satisfying to see, to change someone's life. Like, I don't do a lot of changing of an individual's life. And then in contrast with that, Mirav, who works at the Jewish Funders Network, when I walked in tonight, she told me that she used the Moving Traditions curriculum in a college thing that she said. I mean, the Moving Traditions curriculum is meant for high school students, but she said, I used the curriculum and transformed it so that I could run groups when I was at college at the University of Maryland. And so they're like totally different extremes of what's the satisfaction. So I feel like one of the ways of feeling satisfied is to really, I think you're right, there's no right thing to do, but there's different types of satisfaction one can get.
So I'm gonna add to that also a little bit of a story because I'm connecting with it in that I also try to be strategic and do things that have an impact. Broadly, and I mentioned that my wife and I had started this group called Jewish Youth Connection, which is a outreach-oriented Hebrew school for kids who are not, families who are not affiliated with any synagogue. And one day, I'd mentioned this, that I sort of ended up giving it over to another group who runs it more mostly now, the synagogue that it was in, and we donate to it, and it, you know, are the primary donors. But I don't spend the time in it. But I was I was walking down Lexington Avenue one day, and I go to the programs, and I'd been involved particularly early on, and I bumped into someone who I sort of recognized. You know, you have that moment where you sort of recognize someone. He comes up to me and gives me this big hug, and you know, I'm a New Yorker, so you know, and he says his name, and I remember him. He's a family. He sent his daughter to Jewish Youth Connection for Hebrew school, and he said that, you know, his wife wasn't that involved, but his daughter got involved, and he said the reason he hugged me, he said, is it changed their lives, because today his daughter turned down her offer to go to Stuyvesant, to go to Heschel, where she had received, I guess, a pretty close to full scholarship, having been at our school. And those kind of things, I have to tell you, for me, it was pretty motivating. I don't know, you know, and it was like, it said, okay, like, here's how we, you know, some that money can actually translate into people's lives. And I, you know, I do encourage you. I've actually said this to some people, as much as we do things wholesale, it's actually really rewarding to do some retail philanthropy as well.
One of the ways that longer happens is if your soul is seared by what you're doing, and that's why the time that Sally and Scott and Lisa talked about that they took figuring out their strategies is one of the best investments of time that one can spend, because that allows you to sustain your work.
That's a hard question. So medical research can use unbelievable amounts of money, right? You can give like I'd say actually some percentage of people have my daughter's disease get a certain kind of cancer. And I actually decided early on I wasn't going to give to that because
it's going to be serendipity. Somebody's going to figure out something for some other cancer, and like hopefully they'll be able to use it for what kids who get have an F1 get. The truth was I went out and I gave more money and asked my family members to give more money to NF research than I have ever asked for any Jewish thing, because I think the sums taken to do the work were just very large, and I knew they had the capacity to do that. And I guess I would actually say that I went to my parents, right? My parents are very interested in Jewish education in Metro West New Jersey, Essex and Morris County, New Jersey. And they have given, millions of dollars to education out there. And I feel it's like to Jeff's thing, it's just as good a cause as my causes. So I'm happy they want to do that. And I feel like they should do that. This thing was something that I really cared about and went to them and said, will you contribute to this? So I guess that I've given money to that, and I feel like that's a marathon. This is going to be a really long-term interest, right? Like this is going to be a long process of giving money to this thing. Moving traditions, I used to be a bigger funder of, like, percentage-wise, and then actually I'm just really happy the organization has grown, and I felt like I don't want to keep giving, like, a bigger and bigger percentage. I'm actually happy the organization's growing, and my gift has stayed pretty steady. I wanted other people to be over $100,000 individual donors, and we now, I think, have four or five people who give over $100,000 as individuals a year, not foundations, and I felt great about that. Really, like, I was like, when will other people join me in that size gifts, and I didn't feel like the need to keep increasing it. I sort of felt like that was the right place. And Encounter, I actually gave a large, it was funny, when I changed and became, gave, like in one fell swoop, I went from giving Encounter, I think $10,000 to make giving it a larger contribution than I had given to Moving Traditions, which is what I'd been identified with for, start and for years. And I felt like I really wanted to change the organization. So I guess that the impetus was to really see that if I could do that, I could help to change this organization and make it something different. But that I had the opportunity that doing it slow and steady probably wasn't going to get there, or wasn't going to make the change happen in the way that I felt that we could do that. So I guess that I just, partly is just sitting with myself and seeing also where the need is, what can happen. Like I feel like at Encounter, I've now given the amount that I want to be giving, and I want others to join me in this, right? Like I've made, and hopefully the organization will continue to grow, but I don't anticipate that my contribution has to keep going up because of them.
Any other? Last question.
People are people the large countries getting older. They're not being replaced by younger people. Because they don't have enough money, they don't have enough interest, they don't have enough affairs. What do you think can be done to try and maintain the amount of financial investment? If you look at things, the point that if they're going to go down significantly quickly.
I mean, I think that the key, and this we have to embrace as a community, is that speaking to folks who are younger, is that we have to make the case that the way to change the world is through the Jewish community. We can change this planet because we can model certain behaviors in Israel or wherever that will be, that will make us the demonstration nation, as it were. And we've always been a community, and I think we have to be more full-throated about this, that, we're 14 million people, we're less than 0.2% of the world, but we Jews have not a mission to be better, but to be a mission to demonstrate how we can be instruments for making the world a better place, for how we can be a light unto the nations, and the like. And if we can make that case, then I think future generations will be just as enthusiastic about giving as everyone around this table, with only a few exceptions who are younger. But I think that's really what we have to do. And I think if we shrink from that and we try to put money in foundations, or not foundations, and say, the next generation will allocate these monies. What I found, and this is, I'm speaking now with my business, my kippah of being at Signature Bank, is what I found is that over time, less and less will get allocated to Jewish charities and to, you know, maintaining the Jewish people. So what we need to do is effectively make the case in whatever way and use our dollars to increase Jewish identity meaningfully. And that's the way the next generation will give more. There's nothing we can do beyond that, in my view.
I think that's partly why I decided to put my time and money into my primary time and money into Encounter right now, is because I actually think, I mean, this is just me personally, I think that what happens in Israel is going to have a huge impact on the Jewish people. I heard Daniel Hartman at Hartman, I was there this summer, and he said, you know, every time Israel, you know, does something about whatever I would say negative about religious pluralism or, you know, with what's going on in the situation, the cross-border situation, that another 20,000 Jews drop out of being Jewish. And I think that it's like very, like, you know, it's very, Israel's a very complicated place. And I think that we, I think Israelis and Jews around the world need to really see what's happening there and see the impact that it's having on the Jewish people. So I actually feel like it's really an important issue, and that's why I wanted to put my time into helping people understand the complexity of the issue, because I just don't think the status quo is not going to remain the same. So the question, where's it going to go? And I would joke that, you know, we could have moving traditions groups on every kid in America could participate in a moving traditions group and have great Jewish identity. But, you know, what happens in Israel is going to have, you know, such a big impact that I felt like it was time for me to go back and put time into Israel and actually try to help educate people about what was going on in Israel.
And I'll just say that I feel like I get to work in a hopeful corner of the Jewish community, where a lot of the projects that we support are supported by younger donors and have boards that are young, and they have very enthusiastic supporters because they have created responses to problems and challenges that feel very current and relevant to them. I think one of the things we're going to have to acknowledge as a community is, you know, the only constant is change, and some of the institutions that were bedrocks of the community in a certain era may not be the bedrocks of tomorrow. I don't think that just means, like, you know, everything that is, you know, long established is wrong or bad. I'm not saying that at all. This is not an indictment, but I think we have to be prepared to change and to see certain things morph and evolve and come into new places. But where I sit, I see a lot of younger people getting very excited about Jewish life, going to work for these small organizations, getting very excited about something like Encounter, and saying, you know, this is where I'll put my time, my energy, and my money, because I feel like it's working on a solution that's really important to me.
Can I just add one more thing? Because I really do think it needs to be left on a positive note. You know, that we really, you know, if you read my book, I present the demographic numbers, and they're definitely demographic issues. But, I mean, we are really living in a privileged time. I mean, birthright, which Jeff deserves, you know, almost like applause for almost every moment for, you know, helping create that. And we live in a time when we've got Jewish teen programs that are, you know, we're trying to get those to be better. We have we live in an era where Israel is exporting, you know, tomatoes to Italy and high tech to the United States and all sorts of things to China. I mean, this is a very interesting time for the Jewish people. And I don't think it's a time where we should at all despair. I think it's a time that we should figure out what's working and invest deeply in it. And we'll succeed.
I just want to add to that. I was going to be the contrarian, but I'm no longer the contrarian. I'm enormously optimistic. I'm enormously optimistic because think of what survived, how Judaism survived. And at times when, you know, every Jew wasn't a Jew by choice. Today, every Jew is a Jew by choice. But there's such richness in Judaism. And all you have to do is go on a birthright bus and watch 40, 18 to 26-year-olds transform themselves. 91% say the trip changed my life. And 10 years later, everything from who they marry to what newspapers they read has changed as a result of that trip. All you have to do is go to a moving traditions program and see what's happening. There is so much happening. Now, I will say, and I want to pick up what Aliza said, there are many institutions that are firmly rooted in the early 20th century. They will not make it, because ultimately we are a consumer-driven society, and it flies in the face of community. But unless community is relevant, that's the opportunity we have. And that's the opportunity that each of us as philanthropists has, because we can make the world what you're looking to see. And so the opportunities are there. I want to close with just a couple of points. In your packages is a Jewish philanthropy roadmap that JCF and the Jewish Funders Network put together. The article that Scott wrote, 20 questions that come from one of my books on strategic philanthropy. And the dates of upcoming Jewish Funders Network programs. For those of you who don't know the Jewish Funders Network, BC spent a moment talking about the Jewish Communal Fund at the beginning. Jewish Funders Network is a network of 1,500 people like the people in this room, people who are generous, who care about Jewish giving, and care about what the Jewish world and the larger world will be like. I encourage you, if you want to try something interesting, come to Atlanta March 19th to 21st for the JFN annual meeting. Meet hundreds of people like yourselves. Hear from some of the experts in the field, and get a sense of community as a community of funders. On your behalf, I'd like to thank the panel. You guys were rocking. Thank you.